A blessed Easter to you all. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. We have been, for the last 6 weeks, in the period we call Lent. We began with the baptism of Jesus just before the start of Lent, and we moved through the season of Lent following Jesus as he made his way toward the cross. Thursday night we gathered together for the Maundy-Thursday service of darkness. It was one of those moving times when the sanctuary is dark, candles that are lit are extinguished as the words, the seven last words of Jesus are read for us. We come to that moment when the sanctuary is stripped of all of the worship elements and the pall is placed over the communion table as a reminder of the dreadful cost of our redemption. The problem that we often have, dear ones, is we love Christmas and we can hardly wait to get to Easter, but we skip all of that unpleasantness that goes with Lent and with Holy Week until Easter Sunday. Palm Sunday is okay. Easter is great. The rest of it, not so much. But I want to remind you this morning as we get ready to talk together about the resurrection, that the beautiful candles at Christmas and the carols that we love so much are absolutely vacuous minus the cross. Jesus was not born to be a baby. He was born to be king. He was born to be the sacrifice for our sins on the cross. And if we miss that, we've missed the whole story. It is because of the sacrifice on the cross that Easter has significance. I absolutely eschew what goes on in our culture when they talk about Easter. It's all about chocolates and candy. It's about Easter bunnies and fun things. The message of Easter is the message that death could no longer contain him, because the one who said, "I am the resurrection and the life," is the one who came to life again in order that we might live a new life. And that's what I want to share with you this morning. I invite you to turn with me to John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. This is one of my favorite passages on the resurrection, and I'll tell you why in about 20 minutes. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they've put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from the scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. But Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead, tell my brothers that I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, I have seen the Lord. She told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Join me as we pray. Now, sovereign Holy Spirit, I pray that you would block anything that I say today that would keep people from hearing your voice. And Lord, I pray that they will hear things I don't say. What we long for today is for your people to hear your voice, and in hearing your voice, to be changed forever. Come, Holy Spirit. Amen. It had been a weekend of downward spiraling emotions for Mary. You can imagine the pain that she was going through. There are all kinds of things in this text that I would like to explain to you this morning that help understand why the anxiety that she felt. In the first place, it was a cruel twist of fate that Jesus was executed on a Friday, because on Friday at sundown, the Passover began, and with the beginning of Passover until the end of Passover, on Saturday evening at sundown, no work could be done, no dead could be attended to, nothing could take place during that time. And to complicate the matter, Jewish tradition held that the spirit of a person hovered over the body until the third day to receive the ministrations of the people who would come to pay their condolences and to grieve at the tomb. And we need to understand that the third day is not Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and then Thursday is the third. For them, Friday was the first day, Saturday was the second day, and Sunday was the third day, and this was the day that she was going to go to the tomb, and she wanted to make sure that she got there before the spirit left the body, because decomposition would have begun to take place by that point. And the theory was that as the morph began to disintegrate, the spirit could no longer stand to see the body and would depart. And so Mary was eager to get to the tomb. And you can tell how eager she was by what it tells us that she did and what time she did it. She was probably up all night. She was probably waiting all night long, just waiting for the first inkling of daylight to go. Because what the text says, the word for very early in the morning, it is the last watch of the night. It is the 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock slot, watch in the night. And so she was ready to go at the time the first light showed up. And she made her way to the tomb. And as she made her way to the tomb, the other evangelists tell us, as she made her way to the tomb and the other women as well, they talked among themselves about who was going to roll away the stone so that they could get in and provide the ministrations that they longed to do. And she rounds the bend and sees that the stone which had been rolled over on Friday by Joseph of Arimathea had been rolled back, and the grave was open. Dear one, I want you to understand one thing. I want you to understand that the empty tomb was not a source of comfort for her. In her mind, she had been at the cross. She had seen all that had been done to Jesus. She was one of the people who had seen him mocked and scourged. She had been at the cross when they pierced him with the javelin in his side. She had been there when Joseph of Arimathea had taken him down from the cross. She had followed Joseph to the tomb to watch him place the body in the tomb. She had watched all of that unfold. And now to have the tomb open, it was not a source of joy for her. It was a source of absolute terror, because she thinks in her mind, not only have they done all of these things to him while he was alive, now they have desecrated the body. That's what she was thinking as she came. And she sticks her head into the tomb, and the body is missing from the bier. immediately she goes running to the disciples. And I want you to notice that as she goes to the disciples, she does not go to them with joy. She runs to the disciples and she says, "They have taken the Lord away and we don't know where they put him." And the disciples, you see, Mary was a woman. And women's testimony in that age was not acceptable as legitimate. And so the disciples run to the tomb. John is younger and he can run faster. Peter is older and everybody knows Peter is bombastic, but he's probably also lethargic. He comes lumbering past John at the entrance to the tomb, runs in, and he sees that the body is not there, and it is, in fact, just as Mary has said. It's interesting that John tells us they saw the linen lying there and the cloth that had wrapped his head, the very same words that Mary used to describe to the disciples. John now confirms that is exactly what they saw. It's a wonderful little twist of honoring of Mary that we hadn't thought about before. And they don't do it. The men, sadly, the men walk back to where they were when Mary found them, but Mary is not going to leave. She is not going to leave that tomb no matter what. She sits there and she is crying, she's weeping, trying to figure out what she's going to do next. And she gets up and she looks into the tomb, hoping against hope that all of the things that she has seen before were just a bad dream and the body really is there. She looks in, and this time the body is not there, but there are two men dressed in white, and they ask her, "Woman, why are you crying?" And her response is, "Because they've taken my Lord, and I don't know where they put him." She doesn't bother to wait for any reply from them. She turns back away from the tomb. And she sees a figure off to one side. John tells us that it's Jesus. Mary doesn't know this. And this voice says to her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Now I want you to notice that Mary's response is not, even having heard Jesus' voice, her response is not one of affirmation at this point. Why? Dear ones, resurrections were no more common in Jerusalem than they are in Raleigh. She was not programmed. There was nothing in the software running in her computer system that would filter this truth. And so she hears this voice. It's a voice that's familiar to her, but she doesn't recognize it because he is dead. Thinking him to be the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have taken the body, show me where you have laid him, and I will go and get him." I want you to know that Mary is completely irrational and out of her mind at this point. There's no chance that she is going to be able to carry the body from anywhere to anywhere else, but it doesn't make any difference. All she wants is to be by the body in order to affirm the one who had changed her life. And at that moment, Jesus turns to her and says, "Mary, I want you to hear that clearly, because that is probably the most significant thing that happens in this entire text. Jesus didn't say, 'Mary, it's me, Jesus.' He called her by name. Isaiah tells us, 'Do not be afraid. I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.'" Mary understood what Jesus was doing. When Jesus called her name, all of a sudden, all of the things that had made him special in her life came to the fore. All of a sudden, she remembered all of the things that Jesus had done. We have all kinds of stories about Mary. In the 6th century, Pope Gregory VI issued a proclamation. He conflated the woman who washed Jesus' feet with her tears and dried them with her hair, and Mary and Martha, who anointed Jesus' feet with oil, with the woman who was with Mary Magdalene, who was accused, the woman who washed Jesus' feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair, was accused by the Pharisees around the table of saying, if this man were really a prophet, he would know what kind of woman this is. Pope Gregory VI is the one who conflated all of those and declared that Mary was a prostitute. There is no evidence in Scripture anywhere of those words. Not anywhere. What we know about Mary comes from the 8th chapter of Luke in the 2nd verse, where we are told that it was Mary Magdalene, out of whom Jesus had cast 7 demons. I want you to hear this clearly, dear ones. She was a woman who had a troubled past, but there is no accusation in Scripture of her having been a prostitute. It's very interesting. When you study Scripture, you have to be very careful and read what actually is said. One of my favorites to this point is the parable of the prodigal son, most misnamed parable there is, by the way. The parable of the prodigal son, we are told that the young son runs away. He squanders his living, his inheritance, in wild living. Those are Jesus' words, in wild living. When he returns, the older brother is ticked off with his father, and one of the things that he says to his dad, when this son of yours comes back after he has squandered your wealth with prostitutes. That's the accusation that the older brother made. That was not the point that Jesus was making at the beginning of the story. So we have to be very careful. When we hear an accusation like that, we have to try to discover what the agenda is that's underlying that. And the Scripture is very, very clear if you read it carefully. Mary had 7 demons cast out of her. I can tell you, because I have more experience with the demonic than I would like to admit, I can tell you that wherever demons are present, they are almost always in multiples. And Mary had 7 of them, and Jesus cast them out. Mary became a part of the company of Jesus from that moment on. She and Mary and Johanna all participated in the company of disciples. And the Scripture tells us that out of their own means, they helped to support this traveling band of missionaries. Mary had found life in Jesus Christ. So when Jesus said, Mary, all of the past, that which she had been, that which she had become, came crashing to the fore, and she cries out, Rabboni! And as near as I can tell, it says it means teacher, but as near as I can tell, it is a term of endearment. It's like saying, my teacher. It is the most tender of responses that she has. Here's what I want you to see, dear ones. She came to an empty tomb. The tomb was in fact empty. But the empty tomb did not provide any hope for anyone at any time. Its presence created fear. Mary now grabs a hold of Jesus, and Jesus says, don't hold on to me. Go to my disciples and tell them that I am alive. Mary, reluctantly, undoubtedly, but in obedience to the one who had given her life, turns and she runs to the disciples. And when she walks in the door, this is what she says, not the grave is empty. She says, I have seen the Lord. And dear ones, that is the message of Easter today. The message that we proclaim to the world is not that the grave is empty, but Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Without the cross, without the resurrection, we are still dead in our trespasses and sins. Without the cross, there is no hope. Without the resurrection, there is no power. But the Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead, Paul tells us in Romans 8, will give life to our mortal bodies as well. The message of the cross, the message of the resurrection, is the message of transforming power to live not as we once did, not subject to and trapped by all of the guilt and sin and shame that held us bound before, but we now have resurrection power to live into the new life that Jesus Christ invites us to. It's not an empty tomb. It's a risen Lord. Let's pray. Holy Spirit of God, our prayer is that your resurrection life, by the power of the Holy Spirit, will be manifested in our own spirits and souls, that we might live into the fullness of your blessing and be indeed an always Easter people.
We are Easter people. We live on this side of the resurrection of the cross. And we believe that Jesus Christ came. We believe that he lived. We believe that he died. And he rose again. This is our belief as the body of Christ. This morning we're going to express that in reciting together the Apostles' Creed. I'm going to invite you to stand and join with me. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
the Maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You can be seated. We come to this table today to celebrate our Lord Jesus Christ. As I said, we are on the cross side of the resurrection. But Jesus, on that Passover night, gathered with his disciples. And during that meal, he took the bread, and he lifted it, and he broke it, and said, "This is my body, broken for you. As often as you eat it in remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper was over, he took the cup, and he lifted it, and he said, "This is my blood, poured out for you and for many," that's us, "for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we come to this table acknowledging, believing, accepting who he is in our life, the risen Savior. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the work of redemption on the cross, that Christ went to Calvary's cross for the propitiation of our sins. Lord, he was the perfect Lamb, the perfect sacrifice. He did what we could not ever do for ourselves. And it is in him that we are forgiven. We come to this table today, Father, to acknowledge your Son's brokenness, his blood that covers us and our multitude of sins. Lord, feed us, nourish us, and Lord, as we go away from this table today, may we again proclaim Jesus Christ, risen, Savior, Lord of all. Truly, He is the King of Kings. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. This table is not a Presbyterian table. This is the Lord's table. And everyone who is a believer in Jesus Christ is welcome to come to this table and participate. Bill and I are going to serve you this morning. I'm going to ask our elder, David Rendell, to come and be served first. And he'll be in the back corner. If you have need of prayer for any reason, thanksgiving or concern, he will be glad to pray with you. The table is ready. Will you come?
These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming his flesh. This is the promise of the resurrection. That's what Mary experienced. She realized that the grave could not contain him, and only his resurrection power can give us life and joy and confidence. It is to that we are invited as God's people. Go out into the world to be God's people, empowered by the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Go out knowing that He goes before you into Galilee, and that He is coming again. And as you go, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up the light of His countenance upon you and give you His peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, all of God's children responded by saying,
Amen.